dramatic announcement for you. That requires a bugle call, right? Okay. We are going to do a major fundraising drive here on the Young Turks. But for what? For what? Well, it's the year of Trump. And by the way, the establishment hasn't gone anywhere. We're still also in the year of the establishment. And we fight against both of those. So we have decided that we are going to put together the best investigative reporting team in the country. And we are going to unleash them, both on Trump and the establishment. And, by the way, on the donors. So, in the corporate media, you never hear stories about the donors. Who are they? Why do they want all this influence? What are they getting in return? Whether they're giving to the Democratic Party, the Republican Party, or Trump. See, we don't care. We care about doing watchdog journalism. We don't care to have a side. We don't care if it's the Republican Party that is exposed or the Democratic Party that is exposed, Trump or his opponents that are exposed. What we want to do is to actually investigate and find out what's going on. Do you think the corporate media is going to do it? Hell no. They never talk about the donors. Why do they never talk about the donors? Well, the largest media companies in the world, their CEO just came out and said, oh, Hillary Clinton would have been worse for the First Amendment than Donald Trump. Because she's against the First Amendment. I was like, really? Against the First Amendment? Why? Because she claimed to be in favor of regulating campaign money. In other words, I didn't even believe her, but she said that she wanted to get money out of politics. And then large corporate media says, no, don't get the money out of politics. That money comes to us in the form of billions of dollars in TV advertising. You think TV's going to expose the donors? Who they are, what they want, how much in legalized bribes they give, and what they get in return. They didn't do it under Obama. They didn't do it under Bush. Well, then step aside. Let people do real journalism. Now, you guys know if you've been following the Young Turks, we love to do that. And thanks to the help of our members who helped us to hire an investigative reporter, Jordan Chardon, we broke a great number of stories for you guys. That's just with one guy on this much of a budget, okay? What if we had four new reporters? Not just reporters, but reporting teams. So they're going to go to, we're going to go to Standing Rock. We're going to go to Flint. We're going to go to Washington. We're going to go all over the country. Imagine what we could do. All those other media with the billions of dollars they have, where the hell is their investigative reporting team? How many stories do they break? Because they don't want to break the stories. They don't want to rock the boat. Because that would disturb the status quo, and they are the status quo. They are the establishment. So I'm going to ask you for your help. Okay. So here's how it works. We have an audacious goal. $2 million. But let me put it to you in context. You know what that is? For one of the quote-unquote star anchors on television, that is 10% of their salary. Isn't that amazing? Just one of their anchors makes $20 million a year. You think they're going to rock the boat? You think they're going to have investigative reporting teams? For just 10% of that, TYT will give you the four horsemen. And we will let them gallop. Because we are coming for the establishment. We are coming for the Trump team. If he goes and starts to do any of the things that he promised on the campaign trail, any of the things that his cabinet picks already indicate they're going to do, whether it's destroying the environment, the fundamental corruption that he's already exhibited in terms of helping his own businesses and dealings with foreign leaders, we're going to expose it all. So the good news is, in the old days, you had to go beg, and oh my God, corporate media, please let me out. Oh no, I overstepped the bounds. Now I'm in trouble. And we don't need any of that. Get out the way, yo! Get out the way! Here comes the TYT Army! So, okay, the way you help is you go to tytnetwork.com/go. Now, there it is, tytnetwork.com/go. We'll have that link in the description box, in the comment section. But I want you to understand why we're trying to reach 2 million and how it's going to work. So, you know, when I proposed this goal internally, of course, normal concern is, geez, that's on the internet, that's a lot of money, right? And so, what if we don't reach it? Okay, then we don't reach it. You guys tell us how much you want, right? So, here's how it's going to work. At every $500,000, we're able to put together a team. a reporter, camera people, editors, and the entirety of the team that goes with it, including legal. So if you've been watching this show a long time, I keep talking about it. I'd love to have more resources to be able to do that, but, you know, that's the thing, that although we have almost all the viewers online now, the disparity between the revenue in online and TV still exists. So I said, look, why don't we ask the audience? And I know that they love what we've done so far. Jordan Charton has already broken the Donna Brazile story. She leaked questions to Hillary Clinton. That came from WikiLeaks. Jordan was the first to look through all of that, find it, publicize it, talk about it, challenge Donna Brazile on camera, and then go to CNN and say, can you explain why you're still employing her or why you employed a person who leaked these questions in one of the primary debates? And then Donna Brazile's not with CNN anymore. So if you were a Young Turks member, you made that difference. He went and broke the story in lead poisoning in Indiana, and then New York Times and the rest of the media followed. By the way, you know where he got that tip? You guys. One of the viewers gave him that tip. He followed up on it. Imagine if we had five of them in the view. Jordan plus another four. One of them goes to go get Trump. The other one's going to get the Democrats. The third one's going to get the donors. And by the way, when we say go get them, we're talking about journalism. So if it turns out, hey, you investigate a pension fund and there's nothing wrong with the pension fund, great, fantastic. We'll tell you about that too. Right? But if there is some wrongdoing, since almost no one is on the beat, there's a lot of wrongdoing. My guess is it is going to be a target-rich environment. And so all the things they do to intimidate the rest of the press, well, if you do that, you're going to lose access. I don't care. I don't want your stinking politicians on my show anyway. They're terribly boring and terribly corrupt. Keep them. I got no interest. There's only one thing I need. You guys. TYTnetwork.com/go. So at every 500,000, what we're going to do is we're going to reveal who the new reporter is. So we can't reveal it to you guys because we don't have the money right now. So I can't make an offer to someone if I don't know that we can actually put together that team. The first 500,000 is a bargain because it goes to support Jordan, the new team, plus the DAPL coverage that we promised you. And I think we've delivered pretty well on the DAPL coverage so far. I hope you guys are happy with it. And then if we can get to a second 500,000, then I'll reveal the second reporter. And I already know the people that I want on the team. I think you guys will love the people we have selected. I would love to be able to hire them and then let them do their job. So in the era of Trump, you need watchers on that wall. So TYT is here reporting for duty. Our watch has begun. We are those watchers on the wall. We are the sword in the darkness. Help unleash real journalism in the country. We don't need anybody else anymore but you guys. TYTnetwork.com/go. This is going to be amazing. Okay, we're going to do this for 45 days, all the way through inauguration, and we're going to see how far we get. So you guys tell us, how many reporters do you want? How many investigations do you want? As many as you want, we'll give to you. Now, here's a fun fact. Today, right before the show, I checked to see what the average donation amount was. You know what it was? $27.43. I don't know what it is about that number. It's apparently magic. So keep it coming, $27 at a time. You want a wall? We'll build you a wall of active citizens ready to engage and turn this into a real democracy.
We're drowning in information. Where in all of this is the stuff that matters? The stakes are so high. Your finances, your future. How do you solve this? You don't. You partner with a firm that advises governments in the Fortune 500 and can deliver insight person to person on what matters to you. Morgan Stanley.
Well, it turns out we're going to have a new head of the Department of Environmental, as Donald Trump calls it. It's actually, of course, the Environmental Protection Agency, but he didn't bother investigating that when he was running for president. So, like the corrupt politicians efficiency criticized on the campaign trail, when he got elected to office, Donald Trump decided, let's fill the swamp. Let me go ahead and go to my donors and say, hey, who do you guys want? All the people who donate to me that are in the oil and fossil fuel industry, who's your dream candidate? It's not Sarah Palin for the EPA. It's Scott Pruitt. Now, who is Scott Pruitt and why is he the dream candidate for the fossil fuel companies? Well, he is the attorney general of Oklahoma, and they are one of the largest oil producing and manufacturing states. They do, they've got a lot of distribution centers as well. So let's go to the Washington Post to give you a background on it. Pruitt has spent much of his energy as attorney general fighting the very agency he's been nominated to lead. Great. Their aim is destruction. So you got cops on the street to make sure there are no robbers, take those cops off the street. You got regulations to protect consumers, take those regulations away, make sure the consumers are not protected. Empower the robbers and the robber barons. So let's give you more background. Pruitt, who has written that the debate on climate change is, quote, far from settled. Only 97% of the world's scientists agree. That seems very unsettled, yes. Joined a coalition of state attorneys generals in suing the agency's Clean Power Plan, their principal Obama-era policy aimed at reducing U.S. greenhouse gas emissions from the electricity sector. He has also sued with fellow state attorneys general over the EPA's recently announced regulations seeking to curtail the emissions of methane, a powerful greenhouse gas, from the oil and gas sector. So, in case you're a little amazed by that thing, no, that can't really be true. No, it's true. They nominated the guy who sued the EPA to be the head of the EPA. He sued them several times to say, don't do any regulations, don't do any of this stuff where you're trying to clean the environment. It's the Environmental Protection Agency. I don't want any of that protection, I don't want any of that agency, and I don't care about the environment. They're like, perfect, you're our guy. So who's funding him? We'll get to that in a second. He is described as the leading opponent of the EPA's efforts to curb carbon emissions by regulating power plants. Wonderful. Rhea Sue, who's the Natural Resources Defense Council president, says, over the past 5 years, Pruitt has used his position as Oklahoma's top prosecutor to sue the EPA in a series of attempts to deny Americans the benefits of reducing mercury, arsenic, and other toxins from the air we breathe, cutting smog that can cause asthma attacks, and protecting our wetlands and streams. Senator Edward Markey from Massachusetts says Scott Pruitt would have EPA stand for every polluter's ally. Now, we're not done yet. Let's give you more background, including the people who are backing him and the people that he relies on, apparently, to write legislation for him and to push policy ideas for him. So, in 2014, the New York Times reported that a letter ostensibly written by Pruitt alleging that the agency overestimated air pollution from natural gas drilling was actually written by lawyers for Devon Energy, one of the state's largest oil and gas companies. You see, this is who these guys are. Scott Pruitt has no mind of his own. He's an errand boy. So, Devon Energy writes the policy for him. They hand it to him. He goes, okay, yes, sir, absolutely, sir, thank you, sir. Can I have another donation, sir? Yes, sir, I will now hand this in. Oh, the EPA, I hate the EPA. Oil companies are so right. Who needs to protect the environment? Let's get more arsenic. Let's get more toxins. Let's get more carbon emissions. And then Trump goes, hey, I'd like to fill the swamp. You got any swamp monsters? Prove it. Perfect. Come on in. You have the same donors as I do. More from the Washington Post now. An ally of the energy industry, Pruitt, along with Alabama Attorney General Luther Strange, came to the defense of ExxonMobil when it fell under investigation by Attorney General from more liberal states seeking information about whether the oil giant failed to disclose material information about climate change. So think about that for a second. The other attorneys general for the other states say, hey, let's investigate to see if ExxonMobil is hiding information because we have reason to believe that they are. That they actually know how terrible climate change is. They've done studies on it, but they don't want to reveal it because it would hurt their bottom line. Pruitt steps in to defend ExxonMobil. He doesn't work for ExxonMobil. He's supposed to be working for the people of Oklahoma. But in reality, he does. He works for Devon Energy, ExxonMobil, and all these people who are funding him and his fellow politicians on his side. So he steps in and goes, no, I don't want to know. I don't want to know what ExxonMobil knows about climate change. What happened, big guy? You thought that it wasn't settled. Wouldn't you want to know what ExxonMobil found out about it? Presumably, ExxonMobil found out that, oh, there is no climate change problem. Don't you want to know? Oh, you don't want to know. Because you actually do know what the reality is. There is climate change. It is caused by man. Even ExxonMobil knows. But you step up to their defense. These are the guys that they are putting in charge. Is corruption defined? Pruitt has served as the head of the Republican Attorneys General Association Group, a group that has relied heavily on the funds from ultra-conservative groups and the oil industry. The biggest contributors this year include the Judicial Crisis Network, the U.S. Chamber of Commerce's Institute of Legal Reform, Sheldon Adelson, oil conglomerate Koch Industries, and Murray Energy, a leading coal mining company. So, you have all of these oil and fossil fuel companies and rich Republican donors. They give to the Republican Governors Association and the Republican Attorneys General Association that Pruitt is in charge. And then he takes that money and does exactly what they tell him to do. So now let's go to the industry spokespeople and see what they think of Pruitt and whether they're excited or not. Scott Siegel, who is from Bracewell Policy Group and represents the industry, said, given that we are almost two decades overdue for an overhaul of the Clean Air Act, there is interest on both sides of the aisle to look at that statute. You know what that means? Clean Air Act into thin air. They are so excited. They love the pick of Pruitt. And they're saying, carbon emissions, gone. Regulations on coal, oil, gone. Climate change, don't care. Now we're coming for the Clean Air Act. America, unfortunately, this is what you empowered. We warned you, and here it is. And for those of you saying, give him a chance. Who do you think Scott Pruitt works for? He doesn't work for you. He didn't work for you in Oklahoma. He's not going to work for you as the head of the EPA. He's going to eviscerate the EPA. So, yeah, I'll give him a chance. If all of a sudden he comes in and goes, oh, my God, I just realized that I'm a bribed official for oil companies. Well, I'm not doing that anymore. Let's actually protect the environment. Let's care about American citizens. Great. I'm in. My guess is he's going to go and give them everything they ever dreamed about. Fossil fuel companies are licking their chops right now. Scott Pruitt. Trump's not going to drain the swamp. He is the swamp. You know who makes independent media possible? You guys. Because of you, we can actually do this show free of any outside influence. That's what makes us so strong. Become a member today. TYTnetwork.com/join. You are the media. So the carrier deal, as we've explained to you here, has upsides and downsides. And there's certainly a little bit of crony capitalism because Trump is offering to give them $7 million in tax breaks. And it's just that one company, and it's because they threatened to take jobs out of America. So progressives believe that that is crony capitalism. You're a true conservative. You think it's crony capitalism. What's weird is that Sarah Palin, who is theoretically under consideration for a post for the Trump administration, also called it crony capitalism. Now, that's true, but surprising, given that it's coming from Sarah Palin. Well, Glenn Beck, not a big fan of Donald Trump, and so he was not happy when Sarah Palin supported him in the beginning. Now he's a little giddy about this news, and there's going to be shots fired here.
Let me go back real quick to Sarah Palin. Sincerely, has she had a brain aneurysm? Because I don't know what has happened to her. First, remember how weird that was when she came out and she was like,
I love him. He's great. And I can see him from my kitchen window.
And she was crazy when she endorsed. Then she went out and she was stomping and stumping hard. Then he said, I'm going to consider you for the VA position, which would be good. I think she would get that.
She'd be great at it.
She'd be great at that. But then this weekend, she came out and stood against his carrier thing, which she said is crony capitalism and socialism.
Well, it's to prove she just didn't drink the Kool-Aid.
But
it's so that when she gets the position, she says, look, I'm going to keep him straight.
I hate to quote people that I don't like to quote, but you own it, Sarah. You brought it to the table.
I think she's butthurt. I mean, seriously.
You think so?
I think she's butthurt. I think she's just mad.
Yeah, maybe she's not getting the position.
Butthurt.
Well, there is that story about Last Tango in Paris, so they both...
Okay, I have to confess something I shouldn't have to confess. I also was like, buttered? Okay, so first on the substance here. What little there is of it. Glenn Beck calling someone else mental? That's rich. He might be right, I don't know, not about the brain aneurysm. But Sarah Palin, not the brightest bulb. I think the country's come to a conclusion on that. But this is the guy who believes he cured his mental health problems by going on a gyroscope. He, like, straps himself into this thing, and it spins around, like, wah-zing-dee, right? But if you think Sarah Palin has mental health issues, Glenn, maybe you should let her borrow your gyroscope. Picture the two of them on opposite sides of that studio. And now, onto the even lighter side of this, what is going on with that studio and the camera shots? I know they got bored and they want to get fancy and move the camera around. But, like, shooting this side of his face with, like, 4 bits of the space being empty is just weird. Stop moving the camera! Stop moving the camera! And then, second of all, anyone who sees that, you know what you thought, right? I thought of JR, so he put this compilation together. It's so obvious what they copied. Watch.
I think she's butthurt. I mean, seriously.
You think so?
I think she's butthurt.
Been hiding it.
Peter, come on.
Yeah, you ruined some perfectly good coffee.
Butthurt.
I missed you yesterday, and I held it.
Oh, my God. I don't want to know this about any of these idiots.
Well, there is that story about Last Tango in Paris, so they both... Oh,
you want the same old mainstream media stuff?
Hell no!
I hear you, brother. That's why we got a whole new show on the Young Turks called Aggressive Progressive. Members get the whole show. Do it now. TYTnetwork.com/join. So now we get to the famous carrier deal that Donald Trump struck. So there's a lot of controversy around this, including in progressive circles, including on this show. So on the day that the carrier deal was announced and they said that Donald Trump had saved around 1,000 jobs, I was in favor of the deal, and I explained in the video that I did that there's definitely downsides. They got a tax break that they shouldn't have gotten, but I like that he at least implicitly threatened their parent company's federal government contracts. Now, the parent company has billions of dollars in federal government contracts. Why am I giving you U.S. government contracts if you're moving your jobs out of the U.S.? I think Obama should have done that more. I explained that. Now, others on the show, Anna, John, and others, thought, no, this is a raw deal, and the downsides outweigh the upsides. So, now, let's break it down. I'm going to give you both here, okay? So, first, the more you look into the deal, the more you realize, not quite as advertised. So, Trump last week visited the company's Indianapolis plant to celebrate a deal he struck with Kerry's parent company, United Technologies, to preserve 1,100 jobs there that would otherwise be sent to Mexico. This is what Talking Points Memo explains. Yet that number obscured the fact that some 350 of those positions were research and development jobs that the company never intended to dispatch to Mexico. Oops. Okay. So there you have it. That's one problem with the deal. And a classic Donald Trump exaggeration. Is anyone really surprised? Even if you're a supporter, you know you're not surprised. And then we go to the United Steelworkers president here for this particular plant, Chuck Jones. Now, if you think, oh, union, I'm a Republican, I don't trust the unions. No, they're the ones whose jobs were saved. So they're the ones most motivated to make this deal and to give credit to the guy who saved their jobs. But they also say, not quite as advertised. Chuck Jones says, but he got up there and for whatever reason, lied his ass off when he was talking to them. And now back to the Talking Points memo. They say that he promised on the campaign trail, quote, to tax the hell out of corporations like carrier. So as a way of saying, hey, if you move the jobs out, I'm going to increase tax side. Now, in reality, in this case, the exact opposite happened. So Trump's speech to carrier workers did not address the $7 million in tax breaks that the company received from the Indiana Economic Development Corporation, a state agency, to keep manufacturing jobs in the state. Okay, now, I would prefer sticks to carrots here. If I was the president or president-elect, I would say, hey, listen, you want billions of dollars in contracts? Let's have a conversation. And I don't have to give you those contracts. Now, David Sirota makes a great point. He wrote about this and says, technically, according to our trade deals, that would be a violation. And you're not allowed to threaten their federal government contracts if they move their jobs abroad because of the trade deals. But I don't like those trade deals. I don't agree with those trade deals. And if I was the president, I wouldn't say it. But you know what I'm saying. Anybody can get those billions of dollars in contracts. Now, we don't know to what degree Trump did that. He appeared to have done that, and that's what I give him credit for. Threatening to increase their taxes, well, that's interesting. As a progressive, I don't mind that threat. But if all you did was not any of that stuff, and you just gave him a $7 million tax break, well, that's the oldest trick in the book. That's what every Republican does. Here, my donor friends, here's $7 million. Okay, now let's pretend we saved a lot of jobs when we didn't save that many jobs. So now you're getting to see that it's a little bit more complicated than what you're seeing in the rest of the press about how he saved all these jobs. Okay. Now, more nuance here, more trouble for the Trump in this deal. Again, TPM explains, nor did Trump mention that the United Technologies still plan to send 700 jobs from a separate factory in Huntington, Indiana, to Monterrey, Mexico. As carrier workers from the Huntington factory, many of whom supported Trump, stood outside the Indianapolis plant, holding signs asking the president-elect to not forget about them. So, okay, good. He saved, you know, several hundred jobs. You'll see the exact number in a second. But not as much as advertised. And then there's a whole other plant in Indiana, not helped at all. You give a $7 million tax break, maybe we can help both plants in Indiana. Those guys in the Huntington plant, they're not your enemies. They voted for it. Another case where Trump says, thank you very much for what you've given me, I'll give you maybe half a loaf. Didn't we already have a president talking about half a loaf? All right. Trump and his backers are still pushing for the 1,100 figure a week later, though Jones, that's the union representative that represents those workers, so he would know exactly how many are employed and not employed, said he had heard from Carrier that only 730 production jobs would stay. So just a tiny bit more on the facts here. Mediaite says, with the closure of another plant in Indiana, Carrier is sending roughly 1,300 jobs down south, including around 550 from the Indianapolis factory. So that means that he saved 730 jobs, and they still sent 1,300 jobs down to Mexico. That means he only saved about a third of the jobs that were going to Mexico. That doesn't sound quite as impressive. And if I was going to take out a whooping stick of, I've seen $5 billion, I've seen $6 billion. They're one of the top companies that get federal government contracts. With a $6 billion stick at your disposal, I think you could have saved a little bit more than a third of those jobs. Okay, now back to Chuck Jones. He says, Trump and Pence, they pulled a dog and pony show on the numbers. I almost threw up in my mouth. So apparently those workers know that only a third of their jobs were saved. You didn't trick them. And TJ Bray, another carrier union spokesperson, says, well, in a way, we do. We feel like, you know, we thought you were going to save all the jobs. We had 1,400 people at the facility, union factory, regular jobs. And he didn't say anything about the 400 that were already going to stay. So now, let me zoom ahead to Graphic 36 here because I want to give you a little bit further context. So this past month, November, how many jobs did we add to the economy? Now, well, Obama's president, if you listen to Trump and you're one of his supporters, you might think, what do you mean jobs added to the economy? No, we're losing jobs at record numbers. No, that was out of order. We've actually been adding jobs in sometimes at record growth under Obama. Unemployment is down to 4.6%. In November, we added a net 178,000 private and public positions in that month. Now, do you know how many carrier deals that is? In 1 month alone, under Obama's watch, that is the equivalent of 2,438 carrier deals. So as if you're a Trump supporter and you said, way to save those 730 jobs, you turn around to President Obama and go, oh, thank you. Thank you, Obama. You saved 2,438 times 730 jobs. So let's give context. If he made the threat, even if it's not the right thing to do according to our trade deals, I like that he made the threat. I think that's a strong thing to do. If he threatened raising their taxes, I like it. That's a strong thing to do. And Obama, I stick by exactly what I said on day one. He wouldn't do it. Oh, it's against the trade deals. Oh, my God. The multinational corporations would be upset with me. No. Don't do it. Don't do it. Don't do it. Obama wouldn't do it. Okay? And he was president, and he didn't do it. So, now, if you want to criticize him for that, great. Now, and the president alone is not responsible for all the jobs created in the economy. But the Republicans kept saying over and over, Republicans, it's Obama's fault. The gas prices are too high. The economy's in ruins. No, it was Bush who ruined it. We lost 8 million jobs on his way out. And what we've done is we have regained those jobs. And if you think that everything's because of the president, well, you got to give him credit where credit is due. So, Trump supporters, I assume that you're going to be celebrating all the jobs that we added under President Obama. Now, last thing is you're going to say, oh, Cenk, that's just the last month. No. If you look at the whole record of Obama, you're going to find a record of failure. Really? Well, let's look. Since Obama took office, America has gained 10.9 million jobs. Now, look, I don't think the president is responsible for all that, but I do think he is partly responsible. The deregulation that Bush did, that led the bankers to take tremendous risks, which caused a global economic meltdown, which cost us 8 million jobs at a minimum. President Obama put into policies into effect that regained those jobs and then some. Are they great jobs? No. I think that the average wage is far too low. I wish we had more manufacturing jobs, but credit where credit is due. That's about 11 million jobs created under Obama. Have you given him credit for that? And then to give you a sense of it, Trump saved 730 jobs. Everybody, including me, gives him anywhere from a decent amount of credit to a tremendous amount of credit. How many jobs created each day for 8 years under President Obama? 3,787 jobs a day. That is 5 carrier deals per day, every day, for 8 years. So, the last thing on this is, President Obama, if you got that kind of record, speak up. See, this is what drives me crazy about the Democrats. They'll say, oh, tut, 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 you know, the carrier deal is way overblown. We've created more jobs. But half the time they don't even say that, right? And half the time they whisper, oh, we created 11 million jobs. You're the president! Act strong! Go out there every day and be like, oh, here, well, look at that, another 3,787 jobs today. And another one, and another one. Hey, look at that, it's 5 times the size of the carrier deal. Hey, where's my credit for it? And you say, oh, yeah, that's not the right way to do it. Are you kidding me? That's how Trump won every day. I am the best. I will save jobs. I will make America great again. Oh, that doesn't work. What do you mean it doesn't work? He just won. So, Democrats, stop crying about how the carrier deal is not as good as advertised. And actually make your own case. If you've created a lot of jobs, you might want to tell the American people. And if you don't, you know what will happen? You'll lose elections. Like, what did you think? They were going to magically discover it on their own? How many times did you hear the Democrats bragging about this? And this guy, Donald Trump, created 730 jobs, and you think that he saved the entire planet. You think he created 7 billion jobs. Obama creates 11 million jobs, not a goddamn word about it. Oh, no, that would be impolite. Democrats don't know a thing about politics. They're just a train wreck of a party. It's sad to see them. It really is. So credit where credit is due to Trump for the amount of jobs that he saved, not credit for the ones he didn't save, credit for the threats, not credit for the tax breaks that anybody could have done, which then encourages everybody to try to send their jobs away to Mexico so they get tax breaks from Trump. So be fair about both sides of that. And Obama, be fair that he did actually create a lot of those jobs, and at the same time, deeply frustrating that the Democratic Party cannot figure out how to make a case for themselves, and that kind of weakness is what leads to electoral losses. Sad and true. That's the reality. Podcast the whole 2 hour Young Turks every single day. Commercial free. All Star Tuesdays. Aggressive progressives. Old school. Post games. TYT classics. You get it all with membership. Do it now. TYTnetwork.com/join.
I'm not scared. My hands are just shaking. Oh, that was fun.
The fun's just getting started. You want to turn it now?
Update on what's happening in Standing Rock, good news, bad news, and everybody's got a slightly different take on this. I think there's good reason to believe that, there is a lot of encouraging news, but a lot of people in the establishment do not see it that way. So I want to first give you a quote from the so-called Democratic senator from North Dakota, Senator Heidi Heitkamp. She says about this, when you look at it, we know one thing for sure. When the administration changes, the easement is going to be approved. I understand the frustration of the protesters. I just think that this fight is not winnable. She didn't say that weeks ago. She just recently said, not winnable. How many times do we have to hear that? Okay. That's the Democrats. Theoretically on the side of the people. Gee, I wonder why they lost the national election. Because no one believes you're on the side of the people anymore. And interesting follow-up in Raw story. Turns out Heitkamp was rumored to be under consideration for a Trump administration post after she met with the president-elect last week. By the way, if you don't get it yet, Mitt Romney, Democrats meeting with Donald Trump, anyone reasonable meeting with Donald Trump, he's playing you. That's the way he gets you to do one of two things, which is heal. You go, yes, oh, you're considering me? Oh, my God. President-elect Trump is considering me. Oh, yeah, of course, you're great. Oh, yeah, open mind. Fantastic, right? And he doesn't think you anyway, but you already said it, you schmuck. And that's why you have those pictures of Mitt Romney like this. Okay? So, this is the oldest trick in the book. That's why you have Ted Cruz, a sad picture of him phone banking.
You wake up at 3 now?
This is how we get these people.
At the same time, too. There's
here's what Heitkamp also said. They're talking about, well, what did you guys say when you met with Trump? We spent a lot of time talking about economic development, talking about energy, talking about regulation, and what we need to do there. So it really was a very substantive discussion without a lot of details on positions in the cabinet. In other words, he told me, you know, that I got to do the right things in energy, like the pipeline. He's in North Dakota. That's where the protests are. And regulation, we don't want any, we want to build a pipeline. And because I wanted to suck up to power and maybe get a Trump cabinet position, wow, wouldn't that be amazing? I said, oh, yes, sir, of course, sir. Of course, sir, yes, sir, yes, sir. Okay. Gee, I wonder why Democrats lose. I can't quite figure it out. Now, good news comes from Ring of Fire, and they explain the legal side of this. They say that if oil is not flowing by January 1st, 2017, the 2-year contract expires. Now, I've been telling you about this. The Energy Transfer Partners has a number of contracts for the Dakota Access Pipeline, and some of them expire on January 1st. And then they got to get renegotiated. So let me give you more from Ring of Fire. Though due to massive investment the company has already made, they may try to continue building on the site. Every day that the water protectors hold the land represents a massive hit to investors' pocketbooks. So continuing here, according to Dakota Access's own words in court documents, the delays so far have cost the company a whopping $100 million, and each month will cost them millions more. And they explain one hopeful possibility in this scenario is that when January 1st arrives and not a drop of oil is flowing, investors elect to cut their losses and abandon the project. This is made more possible by the fact that when the contract was initially signed 2 years ago, the price of oil was significantly higher than it is now. As the price of oil has plummeted, so has the reasons for constructing an additional pipeline. So, when they first made the deals, these contracts a long time ago, the oil was around $75 to $80. Now it's down to around $45. So a lot of the people on the other end of those deals might think, I don't want to keep going on this contract. It's not going to be as profitable as we thought. And you're going to still have a tremendous amount of trouble building this pipeline because President Obama is ordering an environmental impact statement. So not so unwinnable as the establishment would like me to believe, including the Democratic establishment. So what does an environmental impact statement mean and how does it end? Well, it takes months to do one. It might take years to do one. And there is basically one way, according to the law, that it ends. So let me read that to you. The environmental impact statement process ends with the issuance of a record of decision, the ROD. So explains the, and this is what it does. It explains the agency's decision, describes the alternatives the agency considered, discusses the agency's plans for mitigation and monitoring if necessary. So I give you that as context. Theoretically, a president cannot come in and go, environmental impact statement that we started according to law, I'm just going to rip it up and I don't care. No, it has to come to this conclusion. And it has to really figure out the impact, hear from the public, give the public time to comment, and make these conclusions. That takes a long time. And every day that that's going on, they're losing money and wanting to, some of their contracts, some of their partners, wanting to pull out of now what is a money-losing venture. See, they were so arrogant when they came in. And it wasn't just against the Native American tribes. They also did eminent domain all throughout the country, including in Iowa. I'll get to that in a second. And they just thought, we have the state on our side. We've already told the government what to do. So if your house is in the way, we'll take it. If your reservation is in the way, we'll just pass through it. We don't have to worry about your history and your ancestors and your sacred grounds or your sacred water. And if we build a pipeline and it leaks, not if it leaks, when it leaks, all pipelines leak, and oftentimes disastrously so, well, that's going to be your problem, not my problem. And I'm not going to check with any of this, and I'm going to tell the government not to do an environmental impact statement, which they're supposed to do. Well, doesn't matter. I get to do anything I want, and I get to run over your land. Well, it turns out you don't get to do that. And we have a say in this as well. So let me give you the final piece of context here. Joey Mahmood, who is the Dakota Access Vice President, he's representing the company, and he said this in court. So this is the company's position. He said the long-term transportation contracts give shippers a right to terminate their commitments if Dakota Access Pipeline is not in full service per the contract deadline. So that is true. And the Detroit Free Press reports a delay in the start of operations would cost about $913 million. Damn. Wait, what? I thought this wasn't winnable. I thought the multinational corporations win no matter what. I thought people power didn't matter. Now, look, there's a lot of money on the line. That means they're not going to go away quietly. So if you think it's over, that's bad news, because I don't think it's over. On the other hand, if you think, oh, those silly water protectors or Native Americans or environmentalists or veterans, all the people who are protesting this, you have no chance. I don't think you know what that means. Their chance of winning, inconceivable. Perhaps you misunderstand that word. Finally, we go to Ed Fallon. He's a former state lawmaker in Iowa, of all places. But remember, they also built through Iowa. They also built through all these other states. And all along the way, not just the Native Americans, they just took people's land. And even the people who objected, they said, what are you going to do? We have all the money. We have all the lawyers. I'm going to do eminent domain on you anyway. You might as well take whatever deal I give you. If not, we're going to go to court, and I'm going to bleed you dry. And you're not going to win against my army of lawyers. So Ed Fallon and others are protesting this in Iowa. And I did not know this, to be honest with you guys. He said, we've had more people arrested in Iowa over this than we've ever seen, even going back to the Vietnam War. You know what we're going to do? We're going to fight you in North Dakota. We're going to fight you in Iowa. And you think it's unwinnable, establishment, Trump administration, oil companies? I think it's winnable. And those veterans that win, there was supposed to be 2,000 of them because they didn't know if they could handle more than 2,000 based on the logistics of the encampment. You know how many wound up showing up? Over 4,000. And I just talked to the guys who organized it. You know what they said? If they try to build that pipeline again, and they ignore the environmental impact statement, and they start drilling again, next time, we're going to bring 10,000 veterans. I think it's quite winnable. You know who makes independent media possible? You guys. because of you, we can actually do this show free of any outside influence. That's what makes us so strong. Become a member today. TYTnetwork.com/join. You are the media. Unfortunately, we have another case of police abuse. This one is in East Point, Michigan. It actually happened in August 10th of 2015, but we now have footage of it. If you're faint of heart, you're not going to want to watch this. So this African-American gentleman is brought in, and his name is Taylor, Frankie Taylor, and they brought him in for driving under the influence. Now, no word on how, you know, under the influence he was. Should they have brought him in? Of course. It's not about that issue at all. It's about how do you treat people. You know, we have the Eighth Amendment. People claim to care about the Constitution. We're not supposed to have excessive punishment, and it's not supposed to be unduly harsh. We're not supposed to torture people. Okay, in this case, as you're about to see, they strap the guy into a chair. They tie him up. And then start pummeling him while yelling, "Stop resisting," which, as you'll see the tape, he's tied in. And then I'll tell you what happened to him. Let's watch.
You keep acting like a child, you're going to get strapped in that chair.
It's August 10th, 2015. Frankie Taylor has been picked up for drunk driving in East Point, and that officer wasn't kidding.
He told me that I was going to be able to use the arm, man.
Officers pick Taylor up and take him to the chair and try to restrain him, threatening to tase him. That's when another officer comes in, puts on gloves, and strikes him repeatedly, knocking him unconscious.
Now, in the beginning, you have some sympathy for the cops. The guy's either resisting or he's drunk, he's falling all over the place. Do they have to put him in the chair? Yes. Should they handcuff him? Yeah, that makes sense. Now, once you've already got him situated in the chair and he's taken care of, you don't have to keep punching him. And that's against the law. That's assault. And to me, the most haunting way, or the haunting part of it, is as they're all holding him down, as you saw on tape, the guy's punching him in the face repeatedly. Stop resisting. Stop resisting. They say it as a matter of course. Like, oh, this will cover us. We just hold a guy down, we tie him down, and we keep punching him in the face. As long as I say stop resisting, then I'm going to be fine. You're not fine. That's, in fact, it's Orwellian, it's gross. Okay, what happened to Frankie Taylor? He's blind in one eye now. They blinded him. So, let me tell you part of the reason why. Not only because they beat him senseless there, but because they gave him no treatment. First, Frankie Taylor now has a quote when he talked to Fox 2. He said, "The guy hit me so many times, it made me cry once I seen the tape. So, it was so bad, he got traumatized all over again. And, of course, he's having nightmares. He got blinded in one eye. So, let me tell you how that happened. Taylor's attorney, James Brazier, said that rather than seeking medical treatment for Taylor's injuries, they transferred him to Macon County Jail the next day. Within days, he was admitted to Detroit receiving hospital for surgery, but it was too late to save his eye. So this is why they call it Black Lives Matter. Because when you strap someone down and you've got four or five cops there and you start punching him in the face and then you refuse to treat him like a human being, and at the very least, after you have assaulted him and maimed him, for God's sake, get a medical treatment. But if you think his life doesn't matter, that he's not a fellow human being, and you can just take his eye and do whatever you want to him, then you don't give him treatment. You never bother taking him to the hospital until days later, and then he lost his eye. To you, it doesn't matter, because that's not the same life as someone you care and love for. What we're asking you to do is treat everyone like their life matters. This is what happens in America. So we expose it so that we can make it better. We've got to do better than this. There's got to be accountability here. There's got to be justice here. And not just for Frankie Taylor, but the cop who keeps punching him as he's saying, stop resisting arrest or stop resisting. You think that's the first time he's done that? You think that's going to be the last time he does that? Get that guy off the streets. I don't trust him with any of the citizens of that area. And then, as always, fix the training. This doesn't happen over and over and over again all across the country because you trained him not to do that. Basically, there is training, not in every police department, of course not, but unfortunately in a lot of them, where they say, do whatever you want to do. We got your back. All you got to do is say, stop resisting. And then you could assault them, torture them, not give them treatment. It doesn't matter. This is in Michigan. In Milwaukee, we told the story of Sheriff David Clark and how he's let 4 people die in his prisons this year. One woman gave birth. They let the baby die there. They never brought treatment until the baby was dead. She was going through labor. She's like, I'm going through labor. The baby's coming out. The baby's out. They won't give her treatment. It happens all across the country because they think that other lives don't matter as much. That's the reality of America. We can fix it together, but you got to acknowledge it so that we can work towards real solutions. The Young Turks isn't just us. It's also you guys. You make this show possible. And we want to thank you for it, and we want to grow together. We want to be too strong. TYTnetwork.com/join. Let's do it.
Andrew, family camping trip. Crank the radio. Strange smell. Smoke. Heat. Welcome to Nowhereville. Population you. Meet Earl. Hi. Bad gasket.
Okay, so give me the bad news. What time on that gasket?
8 a.m.
8 a.m.?
8 a.m.
Done. New gasket. Crank, crank. Crank the radio. UPS delivers to more zip codes by 8 a.m. How we're helping businesses solve for the needs of customers like Andrew.
Donald Trump has been selected as the Man of the Year for Time Magazine. And so a lot of controversy around this. Should he have been Man of the Year? Does it mean that it's a positive thing, or do they somehow mean it to be a negative thing? Well, you know, look at the cover here, and I say it makes all the sense in the world. If Donald Trump's not the Man of the Year or the Person of the Year, who is? The guy won an improbable victory that almost no one saw coming, and he did it in a populous way, totally unexpected way, totally original, unique way. Now, I got 1,000 issues with him, and I don't think that him winning the presidency is a positive thing at all. But the Person of the Year is someone who had the most effect, whether it was positive or negative. It doesn't really matter. But I don't even know who number 2 would be. Who's on the candidate? Hillary Clinton? I don't think so. Now, is he honored by this? Good question. Well, in the past, when he has not won, here is what Donald Trump had tweeted. The Time magazine list of the 100 most influential people is a joke and a stunt of a magazine that will, like Newsweek, soon be dead. Bad list. I mean, I agree he should be Person of the Year, but, I mean, he's a child. Maybe he should have been the Child of the Year. Bad list. Baby. Sad. Okay, now he's back when he didn't win. Now, let's find out what his reaction is when he did win.
Well, it's a great honor. It means a lot, especially me growing up reading Time magazine, and it's a very important magazine, and I've been lucky enough to be on the cover many times this year, and last year, but I consider this a very, very great honor.
So just confirming, you see this as a compliment, not some kind of condemnation.
Well, as an example, when you say divided states of America, I didn't divide them. They're divided now. I mean, there's a lot of division, and we're going to put it back together, and we're going to have a country that's very well healed.
I don't know what very well healed means in that context. It's a little frightening. And I like to say, oh, I didn't divide the country. I don't know what you're talking about. Okay. The other guys are terrible. They're all babies, sad. They're incompetent. They're the worst. They're all failures. Well, I didn't divide anything. What do you mean? I don't even know if the president's from this country. Don't trust people like that. Let's build a wall. I didn't divide anyone. Okay, but again, I think it's inarguable that he's the Person of the Year. And the Person of the Year has been great people in the past and not so great people. Here, let me give you a quick rundown. Back in 1930, the Mohandas was the Man of the Year, Mahatma Gandhi. So if you're pro-Trump, you might think they went in that direction. Other impactful people have been, and of the year, including Vladimir Putin back in 2007, some might take that as an insult. Trump probably takes it as a great compliment. They probably like to wrestle with him one day. And then another Russian leader was man of the year, Joseph Stalin. Twice, in fact. And could you argue that he did not have a lot of impact? He did. He was definitely the person of the year in those years, whether you liked it or not. And remember, that was back when we were allies. So I don't know how time meant it back then, but we were fighting a war together at the time. So, and then the guy we were fighting the war against in 1938, Adolf Hitler, was the time person of the year. And we had not entered the war yet, but we knew that he might be a bit momentous. If you think that's not evil enough, conservatives might be angered to find out another person of the year was Ayatollah Ruhollah Khomeini in 1979. So I wouldn't get too excited that someone's person of the year. Even worse yet for conservatives, this man was man of the year once. Twice. Barack Obama in 2008 and 2012. You don't have to like the guy, you just have to think that he is consequential. And Donald Trump this year has most certainly been consequential. We need independent media to make sure that we hold corporate media accountable. The people that can make that happen is you. You make the Young Turks possible. TYTnetwork.com/join. Join us. Be the revolution.
You can scroll menus for days, or just get what you want. All your favorites you crave, one box, $5, no hard choices. $5 cravings deal, only at Taco Bell.
So now that Trump's been named the person of the year by Time Magazine, there is a new conspiracy theory about it. Of course there is! Okay, so let's show you the cover. Let's see if you can notice what Time did on purpose, according to the people who are alleging this. Do you see it yet? They put devil's horns on him. You see the M above his head? So now we go to Jake Wolf, writing for GQ Magazine, saying, look, we're not here to drum up a conspiracy theory that Time is warning the world of Donald Trump's hidden identity as Satan himself. But we know just how much thought goes into each and every detail of a cover photo, layout, etc. A simple shift left, right, up, or down would have eliminated this convenient graphic design lineup. So it's really hard to think this was an innocent accident. Drums! Okay. Now, it's not like Time Magazine hasn't played with their covers before. Remember the famous darkening of OJ's skin color? That was also Time Magazine. And, you know, in the beginning I was like, oh, come on, get out of here. And they didn't put the head above his head on purpose. Then when I remembered the OJ cover, and he's right, they do obsess over these silly things. And then I thought, that is a curious... I mean, but on the other hand, he's right in the middle. Okay, then you know what I concluded?
I'm in one of those moves, I will fuck you up on this train.
That is not what I meant at all. Okay, then I concluded...
Cerebius!
That's not what I meant either.
Wrong.
Okay, that I meant. So, here's what I concluded. I don't care. Maybe they did it on purpose, maybe they don't. J.R. Jackson, our producer here, says, who cares about the person of the year? Anyway, it's just a shtick. Yeah, I agree. But it's a fun one. Whether this conspiracy is true or not does not lead to any sort of great injustice, okay? If you like Donald Trump, you already hated the mainstream media anyway. And you're going to look at that and see Mother Teresa on the cover. If you don't like Donald Trump, you're going to see Satan anyway. Okay, if this is a conspiracy, the good news is it is the least relevant conspiracy ever.
Yeah. That's the fight! That's the key! That's everything!
I think he did it.
You think yes?
I think it's not definitive. We don't know. We can't read their minds. But it's like making it's making a statement without saying much. The previous covers weren't very flattering of him. He was a melting head,
mm-hmm.
multiple times down to a pile of goo.
Mm-hmm.
They didn't
this, he also talked about how the magazine's going down because of how they treat him unfairly. Probably said something like, you know, something like they're like a playground bully. So I think they have a history of not really liking him. Mm-hmm. So to do it makes sense.
Yeah. Yeah.
But obviously not a big deal.
Yeah. They probably did it. Okay. They asked Trump for his reaction, and he said,
Abi Kibar, Trump, Sarkar.
There's so much you get with Young Turks membership. You get the full two-hour show of the Young Turks every single day. It's commercial-free. You get aggressive progressives. You get all the other network shows that we put together. What else? Post games, right? And other things. And hugs and kisses and rainbows. You know what?
Somebody go get a six-pack.
And let's all enjoy membership together. PYTnetwork.com/join.
Yeah, throw a few bones in there.
I believe it'll be worth the risk. How sure are we about this?
Take it one step at a time. Looks like we're good to go.
What do you mean by good?
I believe that we've been for not to decide.
Bring it on.
You have me.
Okay, my heart.
Slide out. Let me give you orders this time. Thank you.
Hold it together now.
How about this? You're on the same page.
Yeah.
Yeah. And now.
This sounds like you're having fun. Everything in order. It's real pretty here tonight. I've learned by more accounts. The pales in comparison to old Tisha.
Seriously? Got my sights set a little lower for now, but it's only a matter of time.
Wow. If probably heard on the news how the nights are going longer and the demon populations get bigger. People need protection. And if I really give it my all, I think I can provide that for them. Here, you ain't gonna find anything better than all of Mia's, and she's all yours. Well, I guess I got my work cut out for me. Seems Dino's refunds his credit card.
Guys, what, the same thing?
That'll look a lot fancier than something sold at a souvenir shop.
Maybe I'll make a career of it after all.
Welcome back. What do you feel like having today? Thank you for your patronage.
Easy as a bath. Ah.
All right.
You did good. Bye, Ma. I love you.
Gotta make tracks. Ignis, we're going.
On my way.
Cut it out, man. And here we are. Camping. Yeah.
Well, you got a problem with camping?
There's beer. Mm-hmm.
Tiana again.
What? When was she here?
She wasn't. Feeling refreshed. Well, the time gets you stretch out a bit more. Ready for more?
You bet.
Let's hit it.
So not. I don't take a fix to whatever catches my eye. Get some more shots of specs. Gotcha. I'll see what I can do.
not a breather.
Let's see that for the old traps. Take a look at this. Take a look at this. Well, that should do it, huh? sun's cold today.
Yep. Getting pretty dark out here.
Come on, guys. Let's go find somewhere to crash.
Suckers out there. If not, well, I'll still have the memories.
It's disarmed. Man, that hurts. Another headache. This is not normal.
Won't keep you in the dark.
teary-eyed.
Taken care of. Ah, the breeze feels good.
Indeed.
Out of sorts. You need to take better care of yourself.
I thought that's what you two were for.
You see this nut?
It's dissolved.
It's dissolved.
That should do it, huh?
That's all of them. Should be safe now. Oh, wait, we're taking that thing off.
Sorry.
You're going with Joe.
Indeed.
Right.
thanks for your help. With the traps gone, I can make the delivery as promised. I'll be along to Lestalem soon, but if you're headed that way, please send Vina my regards. Everything in order?
Yeah.
Thank you.
decided to part ways with an alt-right affiliated show. Now, this show is called Million Dollar Extreme, and as I've mentioned before on this program, I don't like to refer to white supremacists as alt-right. They're white supremacists, so let's call them what they are. But apparently, they were getting more and more criticism over signing this show, which only aired on Saturday nights at like almost 1 in the morning. Now, Million Dollar Extreme quickly became a headache for the network after its premiere in August due to its close ties to white nationalists. At the show's core was a guy by the name of Sam Hyde, a 31-year-old man with a penchant for anti-humor, racism, and homophobia. So, just to give you a few examples of his behavior on Twitter, which I think is actually par for the course when it comes to behavior on Twitter, he referred Lena Dunham as a fat pig. She had commented on the Alton Sterling case. And then, I guess some video game showed a woman wearing what appears to be a hijab upset him. I'm getting tired of seeing burkas in video games. Now, the video that I'm about to show you makes it seem like you might be high on mushrooms as you're watching it. I don't understand, like, the appeal to it, but apparently it did relatively well on Adult Swim. So I want to give you an example of what the show was like. Take a look.
Irish girls. Those piss-ended Jameson drinking daddy's girls. Don't you wish you could just fucking suck your dad's dick? Don't you wish your dad came home from his office one day, unloosened his fancy Brooks Brothers tie, and took his pants off and let you suck his dick, Megan? Nah. Maybe so, maybe no. And then someone in the group of girls knows one girl that had this happen to them. This is the story. I had sex last night, and I got a tampon shoved in the back of my cervix because I forgot that I had a tampon before I had sex. And your dick acted like a muzzle loader and shoved a tampon to the top of my vagina. Why does everybody know someone that happened to? I know two different girls.
Okay, so I get why it had decent ratings, and they say that it did at 12:15 a.m. Because if you let guys talk like that, it doesn't matter, left, right, etc., it's going to grab a little bit of attention. Of course it is. So if you're flipping through the channels and you've got the vanilla stuff all over TV, you know, like it's anodyne and doesn't offend anyone because they want to sell ads to Tide, and then you've got this guy talking about, oh, you know, you want to talk to dick, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, people are going to pause for a second. It doesn't mean it's quality programming.
You can get similar entertainment without having to pay for cable by just going to your local bar at like 1 or 2 in the morning.
Yeah.
I don't know, I'm just saying.
So, so far out of the stuff that we've presented, though, I don't see a reason to take them off the air. So, but we're going to get to more. So, he calls Lena Dunham a fat pig. That's like his opinion, man. Now, he's a dick for saying that in the context of her tweet about Alton Sterling and police abuse and someone being killed, and your reaction is, oh, that's a good point about someone being killed by cops, except you're a fat pig. Okay, well, then you're a jerk, but you're allowed to be a jerk in America, and you're allowed to have a TV show. Now, of course, the station gets to make any decision they want, but he doesn't like seeing burkas in video games. I don't care. I don't care. You want to be right-wing, and you want to try right-wing humor? Maybe it'll work. I mean, this isn't really humor. All they're just going around going, fuck dick, cervix, right? So, it's like, wow, you guys are really funny on the right. So, all that, you know, I view as not that big a deal, you know? And a lot of the people who work on Adult Swim were pissed, and the actors and directors and writers and producers started saying, hey, I don't want to work with a channel that has these guys on it. Okay, so what's the big deal about it? Well, there are issues here. So, typical comment back in a 2013 video from Sam Hyde is he called some guy in front of him in a line a hipster faggot. I'm quoting him. So, you know, of course, it's okay. They think it's like so funny if they insult other people in a way that is offensive. They're like, I called you a Chinaman! Orient! Ah, I'm so funny! I'm so funny! I'm willing to offend you! Yeah, first of all, it's a one-trick pony. Like, we got it. You're a dick. How long can I watch that? So, then, alright, fine, you want to say, okay, that's, again, his opinion. And he's a jerk, so what? here's the part that I can't quite get past. It, Adult Swim standards, once brought up, that standards sometimes are a pain in the ass on TV. And so they'll nitpick you on prime time and stuff. So I'm not a big fan of standards. And we curse on this show. We don't care, right?
Quote of the day.
I know, right? Not a big fan of standards. Anyway, that's what it's called in TV, the standards cuts, right? But in this case, they found hidden swastikas in the show.
And they literally had to tell them, can you guys, like, not have hidden swastikas on the show? Like, just take them down.
So when they censor benign jokes by Seinfeld on air, it's like, standards, calm down.
Right.
Okay? When they remove hidden swastikas from your show on Adult Swim, that's what they're supposed to do. Yep. That's it right there. And if you've hidden swastikas, that isn't cute, that isn't funny, and yeah, then other people got to have all the right in the world to say, I'm not going to work with a guy who does shit like that. So I don't care what his opinion on cervix is.
So there was apparently a on-air star at Adult Swim that decided to quit because he couldn't take it anymore. This is from Brett Gelman, and he says, I'm all for free speech, and I don't need my viewpoint to be the only viewpoint, but I'm not for something that mobilizes propaganda. That was his statement. And, you know, in addition to the things that Cenk listed, they like to do these, like, ridiculous pranks where if they found a woman unattractive, they would purposely trip her into a glass table. Right? Now, I don't know how much of that is staged. I don't know how much of it is real.
It can't be real. That's assault.
Yeah. It's just, but regardless of whether it's real or fake, it just sends a really bad message.
That's a terrible
it's
message.
It's needless cruelty. Like, cruelty for the sake of cruelty, and you think it's entertaining.
But you know what they are? They're like Biff from Back to the Future, mm-hmm. right? Mm-hmm. And so they think, like, being a bully is hilarious. So, and it's a one-trick pony. Just offend people and then tell girls they're ugly because you can't get laid. And then if you're frustrated enough, push them. Physically assault them. Isn't that funny? I not only offended you by saying horrible things, but then I assaulted you. That's so funny. I'm a right winger. And I don't know what the fuck comedy is. The whole 2-hour podcast of the Young Turks, commercial free, all the network shows, and you get to be part of independent media.
This is huge.
It really is. All that at tytnetwork.com/join.
Lawmakers in Ohio have passed very restrictive abortion legislation. And now this is legislation that passed both in the House and the Senate in Ohio. And now it's up to Governor John Kasich to sign it into law. Now, before I give you the details, understand that if Kasich does not veto it, let's say he doesn't sign it, but he doesn't veto it, he just leaves it alone, it will become law in Ohio. Now, the Ohio House and Senate did pass a bill that would essentially outlaw abortion by criminalizing it when a fetal heartbeat can be detected. Now, understand that a fetal heartbeat actually starts pretty early on in the process. The heartbeat can be as early as 6 weeks into gestation, before most women even know they're pregnant. The bill will lead to a complete ban on abortion with no exceptions other than to save the mother's life. Similar legislation passed in states like Arkansas and North Dakota, but they were deemed unconstitutional by the United States Supreme Court in January. So should this go to the Supreme Court, which many people think it won't even get to that point, it would likely be found unconstitutional, but the lawmakers are trying their luck considering the fact that in Donald Trump's administration, it's likely that he will nominate a very conservative Supreme Court justice who will vote in favor of this type of legislation.
So it has begun. We told you that Donald Trump and his Republican Party were going to try to do extreme things. This is absolutely extreme. It is clear law set in 1973. That it is unconstitutional to try to limit the right to an abortion until viability, which is 22 to 24 weeks. Now, some Republicans have been trying to chip away at it, get it down to 20 weeks, come up with all sorts of different regulations about the size of the hallways of abortion providers, et cetera. Funny enough, all of a sudden they love regulation and big government when it comes to our personal lives. In this case, they just dispense with it. They call it the heartbeat bill because they think it's clever, but it's very hard to know that you're pregnant until about 6 weeks in.
And yeah, most women find out after 6 weeks. It's very, very early for them to find out before that. They do sometimes, but, you know, at 6 weeks, most women have no idea. I want to also note the way that this passed in the House and Senate was also very shady, and it's something that's common in politics. What they did is they tacked this piece of legislation onto a different bill that has nothing to do with abortion, right? So the other bill has to do with mandated reporting for medical professionals. And then they're like, okay, let's slip in the anti-abortion stuff, right? So if you're a lawmaker and you're in favor of what the bill is really about, but you're not in favor of the anti-abortion stuff, what do? Some of them just go ahead and they vote in favor of the legislation.
So, look, the establishment drives us crazy, but, you know, that's why we fought them in the primaries. But at the end of the day, the Supreme Court is relevant. And so, and there was a seat open. God knows if there'll be more seats open. And Donald Trump promised to put someone in that is massively conservative.
Yeah.
And already we have many members of the court who are massively conservative. So you think they care about precedent? Now, conservatives, judicial conservatives, are supposed to care about precedent more than liberals and progressives, but they actually care about it less. If they don't like it and it doesn't match their politics, like, who cares about precedent? Yeah, we're done with it. Roe versus Wade, we're done with it. Are they definitely going to do that? I don't know.
Yeah.
We don't even know who the Ninth Justice is going to be.
Right.
But is it possible? It's certainly possible. That's why these legislators think, yes, it's our time now. Finally, we get to take away your right to an abortion. And by the way, along with that, your right to privacy altogether, which was also part of the Roe versus Wade decision.
Right. Another thing to keep in mind is Donald Trump's inability to kind of understand how all of these processes work. So during an interview with Leslie Stahl, he was asked about abortion rights, and he essentially said that he believes that regardless of what the Supreme Court has ruled back in the 1970s, abortion should be a state's rights issue, right? So some states can legalize it, some states can restrict it or ban it. It's up to the states. Then he was asked about gay marriage and what he plans on doing about that. He's like, well, the Supreme Court has already decided that same-sex marriage is constitutional, so I'm just going to leave that alone.
In other words, I have rich gay donors, and so I don't care about that issue. But I'd like to get the Christian voters, so I'll say, yeah, sure, whatever. We're going. You're not going to have a choice anymore. So one final thing. It does go to Kasich.
Yes.
Now, Republicans told us there's a big difference between Trump and the other Republicans who are moderate and sane. This bill has no exception for rape or incest. Kasich has said in the past that he's against that. So we're going to find out who John Kasich is. If he does not veto this bill, then he's just as extreme as Trump or anyone else.
Right.
And if he doesn't veto it, then the court will temporarily block it, very likely because of precedent. And then once we get the new Supreme Court justice, we'll find out if we have rights anymore in this country. So we warned you, and here it is. Podcast the whole 2-hour Young Turks every single day. Commercial free. All-Star Tuesdays. Aggressive progressives. Old school. Post games. TYT classics. You get it all with membership. Do it now. TYTnetwork.com/join.
Recently, Van Jones had a special on CNN where he talked about a number of different issues, and he had politicians like Rick Santorum on to answer some questions from the audience. There was one audience member by the name of Elizabeth who actually immigrated here to the United States when she was very young. She was 7 years old, so her parents brought her in illegally before she even knew anything about immigration or being an undocumented immigrant. Now, during this Q&A, she asked Santorum about what she should do as a successful, accomplished woman who, unfortunately, does not have citizenship yet. Take a look.
Growing up here in America, one thing I always heard was that there was a shortage of individuals who entered careers in science, engineering, and technology. And so I decided to be part of the solution. I actually earned a degree in mechanical engineering. I have a career in the technology sector, and I've spent almost a decade working with students, getting them to focus on entering careers in engineering. And I stand to lose all the work that I've done if the new administration decides to end DACA, which is the program that allows undocumented individuals like myself to have the ability to work. It's not an immigration status, it's just the ability to work. my career will come to an end if that program ends, and I will also potentially be labeled for deportation, which means that I'm going to be removed from the community that I've contributed to so much. And so as 2017 starts, I'd like to ask for your advice. How would you advise somebody like me for planning my future and what lays ahead?
So I wanted to give you guys her question, and you know, in that question, she shares a lot about herself and how successful she is, and she's a female engineer, you know, so...
That's what I think we wanted, right?
Right.
And so you see Santorum go like... Like, at that moment, you think, there's got to be a little bit of compassion in this guy, right?
Right, because look, there's this narrative that people, specifically conservatives, like to paint. Regarding undocumented immigrants, right? Similar to what Donald Trump said in the beginning of his presidential campaign. You know, Mexicans are sending rapists and criminals and whatever. And a lot of people buy into that. But the reality is there are a lot of undocumented immigrants who come into this country just looking for a better life for themselves and their families. And they don't cause any trouble at all. Now that we know who this woman is and what she's accomplished, let's see if Rick Santorum has any empathy for her whatsoever. Take a look at his answer.
My own personal story is my father came to this country when he was 7 years old. And the reason he came when he was 7 years old is because he wasn't allowed to come here.
Wait, how old was he?
I was seven.
So,
he was 7 years old.
Right. So, and he wasn't allowed to come because there was a law in place that he couldn't come. My grandfather was here and spent the first 7 years living in America, working in America, but was not allowed to be with his family because of the immigration laws at the time. And I remember asking my father how, and he was in Mussolini's Italy. Not a very, very, very pleasant place to be. And I remember asking him, and he hated Italy because it was a horrible childhood in his mind. And I asked him, I said, you know, did you ever resent America? He said, no, America was worth the wait. It was worth doing it the right way. And I think what most people in America feel is that you've been given a tremendous benefit by being here in this country. You just described something that, I don't know where what country that your parents came from. But my guess is you wouldn't have had the opportunities to be able to accomplish what you have. My final point is you have the ability to go to any other country right now and apply those wares and be successful, and then reapply to come back to America if you so choose. So,
wow. In other words, get the step. And it is a classic Rick Santorum answer. You know, hey, you came here when you were seven, so my dad. And, you know, the laws were not on our side at the time. The laws are not on your side at the time. Ha ha. I got to stay, and you're not going to get to stay. So I don't know the different regulations that were in place when his dad came over, and it was a confusing story about his family, right? But I thought for sure, did you think that as he's explaining that story, he's going to say, so I relate to you, and I want you to stay, but... You know, I get that the butt is coming, but at least give me like, boy, my heart goes out to you. We lived through the same thing. No, he set that whole thing up, and he's like, bye, Felicia.
Yeah, totally.
What?
Totally. So, okay, look, I want to, of course, start off with the caveat that I don't think that people should just be able to come into the country as they please, right? You're breaking laws when you do that, and if you're an adult who understands... Well, yeah, there's obviously certain...
And you're voting Republican, then just come on.
Yeah, that's a little different, right? Mm-hmm. Cubans get amnesty because of...
Because they're Cuban.
So anyway, let's move on to something else. What I really want to focus on, though, is the difference between an adult knowingly and willingly entering the country illegally, which, again, they're breaking the law, and then a child who was brought into the country before they even understood what was going on. They, I guess, technically also broke the law, but their children, their parents brought them in. This is the only country that they've ever known. Now, if they've been here all their lives, or the majority of their lives, and they've done great things despite all these obstacles against them, keep in mind, she's an engineer, right? She didn't get all of these perks and benefits that U.S. citizens get when it comes to going to school, right? You have to go through a lot more obstacles in order to pay for college, in order to get accepted into certain colleges. So she basically dominated those obstacles and managed to be as successful as she is. We want people like that in the country.
I thought Trump said he was going to build a big, beautiful door for people like that in the country. So look, here's what I think is the right answer, but Santorum's not capable of it. So, by the way, I came into the country when I was 8. We did it in a legal way. So I can do like Santorum and go, we did it legal, sorry. Ah, go back to wherever the hell you came from. You're lucky you got to stay this long. And I get to burn the bridge after I crossed it, right? But no, I think, look, of course we want you to do it the quote-unquote right way. We want your parents to do it that way. But you built something here, right? So it's not like you're freeloading. And by the way, a lot of undocumented immigrants actually pay payroll tax, and since they're undocumented, never get that back in Social Security and Medicare. So they don't tell you about that. So they paid for that as well. And so I think there needs to be a reasonable path to citizenship.
Yes.
So you don't just get citizenship right away. But right now, the legislation they have is, and the one that was defeated, is for 14 years of working here before you can apply for citizenship. That is twice as long as indentured servitude. Remember when you were taught that when you were in school and they're like, oh, man, besides slavery, there was indentured servitude. And if somebody brought you over here just for the price of coming here, you'd have to work for them for 7 years for low wages. These folks have to work for 14 years. That's enough. That's enough. And by the way, most of America agrees. Over 60% of Americans agree. But yet somehow Republicans like Rick Santorum have found a way to block the will of the majority over and over again. And so the reason I say it's a classic Santorum is he has no empathy like other people. Like conservatives, really deep right-wing conservatives, he thinks it only matters if it happens to me. So he, when he was a senator, pushed for tort reform and said no one should be allowed to get more than $250,000 for medical negligence. Doesn't matter. You know, your wife, your kids were crippled, your parents, whatever, there's a terrible mistake, negligence, recklessness, it doesn't matter. Your award should be capped at $250,000. Then his wife had a medical issue. You know what he sued for? $500,000. Twice his own limit that he proposed as a senator. When they asked him why, he said, yeah, but that's my way.
Damn.
You know you want to get TYT membership so you can get the whole 2-hour show commercial free, all the network shows.
Go ahead, girl.
TYTnetwork.com/join.
One of the most successful YouTubers is a guy in Sweden by the name of PewDiePie. A lot of you have probably already heard of him. He does gaming videos, he does personal vlogs, he does a lot of content, and he's tremendously popular. Now, recently, he put out a video talking about some of the downsides of YouTube that led to a lot of controversy. Now, he argues that YouTube has now come up with certain algorithms and certain features that work against his channel. Now, mind you, reports indicate that in 2014, he made somewhere between $7.4 million to $12 million. Variety reported that he made $12 million in 2014. Now, his main grievances in this video stem from a number of product changes to YouTube that caused his videos to not perform as well as they used to. Now, he did a long video about this, and we can't show you all of it, but he was mad because some of his personal vlogs didn't reach 2 million views. Anyway, and then there was this one part that people kind of either took out of context or misinterpreted. Let's take a look, and I'll kind of give you the details behind what's going on.
YouTube wants to kill my channel. It's because I'm always complaining to them. I don't have family-friendly content. I clickbait too much, huh? Is that it? It all makes sense. YouTube wants my channel gone. They want someone else on top. Someone really extremely cancerous, like Lily Singh. I'm white. Can I make that comment? But I do think that's a problem. And I'm not gonna let YouTube win. I'm not gonna let YouTube defeat me. So I've decided the only way to stop my channel from dying. I know you're gonna think I'm joking right now.
It's close.
But I'm gonna delete my channel.
So he has somewhere in the ballpark of 49 million subscribers, and he said that once he gets to 50 million subscribers, he's going to go ahead and delete his channel to kind of make a statement to YouTube. Now, I don't think he's really going to do that, and I also don't think that the statement he made over there about being white and how it's working against him was meant to be a serious statement. I think he was being sarcastic, but people in the media don't, like, it didn't register with them, like, does not compute, not sarcasm, this guy must be racist.
Yeah. So, of course he's kidding! Of course he's kidding! It's certainly about the white part and all that. And you don't know his politics at all. So, but what's funny is that, like, the white supremacist guys got alongside it. They're like, oh, yes, PewDiePie on our side? No. Bad news for you, again. So, he's kidding about Lily Singh. Now, I would be shocked if he actually deleted his account, so I think he's, that's also, you know.
It's such a clever strategy. Everyone's talking about it. He's going to get to 50 million subscribers because of this stunt. It was
he would have gotten there anyway, but it's a good stunt. But
he raised a lot of really, really interesting issues with YouTube. And look, YouTube is constantly changing, right? Like, once you finally, like, get how YouTube works and you know, how the subscriptions page works and all that, all of a sudden they change things around, right? Because they want to keep evolving and they want to remain relevant, which I get. But sometimes those changes can negatively impact you if you're a big YouTuber. And so that's where his concern comes from. Now, look, it's hard for me to feel sorry for him because Homeboy made $14 million. No, sorry, $12 million in 2014. I mean,
imagine
if I
the
made...
way he's going to make this year, but he's much, much larger.
My personal YouTube channel made $12,000 in 1 year. I'd be like... To be fair, I don't really... I'm not acting
on it. No, she could be, though. okay. So, look, he's a one-person operator, basically. Now he's, I think, probably a couple guys as well. And so, that's mainly profit. Bless his heart. Okay, whereas some other channels have 60 people working for them, not all profit. Okay, so anyways, when YouTube messes with the algorithm, it is problematic. And so... we've been on YouTube for over 10 years. I love it. It gives us independence. We didn't have to listen to any gatekeeper show we want. They just got to be a little bit careful about how they play around with the algorithm. Because I know that they've got different incentives and they want to bring in new people. And my guess, and I'm only guessing here, is that they think the ones that are already on YouTube are so dominant, whether it's us, PewDiePie, or whoever else it might be, that
they want to give
it discourages
people.
Competition. Because, I mean, that's part of the reason why we have those shirts that say too strong. Because people say, like, you can't compete with the Young Turks on YouTube, so they don't even come on. So I understand why YouTube wants to encourage new people to come on. But if you do it at the expense of the shows that have been with you all along and that have already proven how popular they are, that's a perverse way to get there.
Yeah.
And so I can understand PewDiePie's frustration. It doesn't matter how much money he makes. So that's his business. That's not anybody else's business.
Right.
And so, and you shouldn't punish success. And so, look, these are real issues. What's not real is him being a racist against Lily Singh. It's just, it's sarcasm. It drives me crazy when people can't understand sarcasm. I once did a joke a long time ago about how I was going to sue Stephen Colbert because we made the same joke about Klingons. I was just messing around, right?
Yeah.
And I did a video and I was like, Stephen Colbert, up against a wall, motherfucker. Because that's what OJ had just said when he got rearrested.
Yeah,
he was going to take his memorabilia back. And I was kidding around. We're liberal. Stephen Colbert is liberal. No one got the joke. They're like, this unhinged man has threatened Stephen Colbert. No, you schmucks. We're messing around. I don't actually think he stole my Klingon joke. Okay. But it's subtlety is lost, and humor is lost on a lot of right wingers. So I'm not surprised by that. Anyway, I think that if you're YouTube, there's a way to balance encouraging new people to come in without punishing the people who your audience loves and thinks is popular. And by the way, just one last thing about the idiots who think that they're punishing him because he's white. No, it's happened to all the channels, including ours. And from what I hear from our critics, we are far too brown. You want the same old mainstream media stuff? Hell no!